Hello, I'm Rory McKiernan and welcome to the Love and Courage podcast. This is a community supported podcast made possible by donors and patrons like you. You can help the podcast grow by subscribing to it, leaving a review and a rating, and by spreading the word wherever you can. You can also support by becoming a donor or a patron and receive a Love and Courage t-shirt, badge, special mentions online, and discounts on future workshops and events. You can find out more at loveandcourage.org. Thanks so much for your support. It really means a lot and is hugely appreciated. I hope you enjoy the podcast.
It's very hard to explain to people how to have the courage to stand up and go, I'm going to give this as good a go as I possibly can. And I don't care what anyone says. And like literally, I don't care what anyone thinks of Rusangano because I'm having the best time doing it. But if you can kind of throw off the shackles of worrying about what someone is going to think, or whether someone is going to judge you in some kind of way, you find that it just becomes so easy because you're so relaxed, like trying to achieve what it is that you want to achieve. If you achieve it, brilliant. If you don't, well, nothing ventured, nothing gained, but you probably end up on a very interesting path in life where there's so much more adventures that are about to come.
My guest in this episode is John Lillis. John is a DJ, producer and teacher based in the west of Ireland. He is one third of the Rusangano family, a high-powered hip-hop act who in 2017 won the Choice Music Prize, Ireland's biggest music award. Growing up in rural Clare, John immersed himself in music culture, collecting records and entering radio competitions daily. His approach has always been a DIY one, and he's been a major part of growing the hip-hop movement in Ireland. A passion for community music and event management led him into the field of youth work, an area that has deeply inspired his creative work and thinking. When not touring the world supporting the likes of Snoop Dogg or hanging out with Ed Sheeran, John is back in his beloved Clare, helping empower the next generation of musicians. John's love for music is part of his fierce passion for life, something that is truly infectious, which you'll hear now in this fascinating interview recorded in the rooftop office of First Music Contact in Wicklow Street in Dublin. John, thanks very much for joining me on the podcast today. You're on the crest of a wave. Congratulations on the Choice Prize.
Thanks a million. It's great to be here. And I don't think we probably could have done this podcast earlier in the week because probably would have been stumbling my words and been quite confused, because obviously winning the Choice was a huge thing for us, and it's taken a couple of days to kind of come back to normality, but we're definitely grounded again now.
So it has been a spiral of media and adrenaline and phone calls and texts. And
For sure.
And it caught you by surprise, I believe.
Yeah. It definitely caught us by surprise. Because I think when you're in a competition like The Choice, so we understand that we're a good live act and that we'd like to think that we make good music. But then when you're up against the caliber of some of the people that were on that, it's just phenomenal that you could take, you know, a hip hop album that's essentially made in someone's spare bedroom down in the west of Ireland and put that in the same category as something like Katie Kim or Lisa Hannigan or All Twins. I spent enough, going back a couple of years ago, I spent a lot of time watching a group called Adebisi Shank, who one of the guys in All Twins was in this group, and they had done everything in a kind of a DIY capacity. And then when he's shaking your hand on the night and says, you know, well done, it's like, well, we wouldn't have done this if it wasn't for people like you. And
yeah,
it's just really inspiring for us. And it also, I think, certifies what we're doing to a certain degree, where you don't feel like a chancer at it. And it's not that we feel like chancers at it, but it definitely means a lot to us for the music community of Ireland to turn around and kind of just give us the nod and say, you know what, like, this is different, but it's still part of this scene, it's part of this community. And we felt very welcomed, I think, by, you know, the last year has been phenomenal for us, and phenomenal in terms of just that feeling of support from people. So we're so indebted to the people of Ireland. Like, really is it's a very inspiring thing for sure.
And like, when you say get back to normal, like, I don't have an impression of this kind of peaceful, quiet normality that you're just kind of sitting at home doing the dishes. Like, it sounds like you're the last year has already been a kind of a wave of madness and excitement and travel and adventure. And
for sure. Now, that said, like,
we now all, I know you probably
we do, all do the dishes. Dishes. We all do the dishes, right, for sure. But I suppose the best way to put it is, for us, it's really about balance. So while we do a lot of shows and we travel, and Rusangano is now part of our lives, and we kind of live Rusangano, if that makes sense. But when we're separate from each other, or when we're not actually active kind of within the group, we take our off time very, very serious. And someone was saying this to me recently, where they were like, oh, you know, are you up in Dublin all the time? Are you out? Are you socializing? Are you? And I was kind of like, actually, no, I'm going for like really long walks in the woods, and going up the burn, and feel like that kind of balance between the craziness of gigs and the high energy of being on the road, or, and because we're an independent group, we have to do everything ourselves, so your phone is always on, you're always answering,
you're a manager, publicist, every other thing
pretty much,
and that quest for balance, like, so you're in your what, mid to late 30s?
Let's put me in my mid 30s.
Okay,
yeah. I'm still in that area.
Okay, you're 37.
Not yet.
Okay Well, okay,
getting
so,
there.
So you know, I've burnt myself out a number of times, and it's still a challenge for me that, you know, the excitement happens, or the cause calls. But I do feel that with every year that I get older, I'm getting a little bit wiser, hopefully.
Yeah.
And I live a little bit on the outskirts of Dublin City, so I have access to nature. I go for those long walks, and I don't feel I would be able to, like, really be in the world and thrive in the busy world if it wasn't for that counterpoint.
Definitely.
Is that what you're
going to get? That, you have it exactly. For me, and I suppose for the guys as well, like, we're very proud of being from the west of Ireland, and we're probably in a position now where people would suggest, you know, you should think about moving to Dublin, or you should think about moving to London. And it's so far from our minds where it's kind of like, yeah, we could. But we've come this far. We always drive back in the same night. So for me, it's like a gift to be able to get up on a Sunday morning. You played in Dublin on a Saturday night. To get up on a Sunday morning, have breakfast in your own house, and be like, I'm going up the coast, I'm going to Doolin, I'm going to try and get into an environment that's the complete opposite of the night before. And really, like, a big believer in energy. And when we do a show, you're giving quite a lot of energy.
Yeah, you're pumping out the energy.
Like, not so much me, but definitely the two lads.
Yeah.
But there's definitely an exchange of energy that's happening in the room.
Yeah.
For me, it's like the following day, it's really important that you're eating good food, that you are outdoors, whether you're going for a cycle, whether you're going for a walk, anything like that, but just kind of getting back to nature. And because there's, you know, look, if you talked to John from 10 years ago and I was put into this position, I go to play, you know, that gig on a Saturday night, and I wouldn't be going home until Thursday of the following week. But now I think I'm a little bit more grounded, and I realise that, like, I don't actually want to, when we do this, we want to take it very serious, and we want it to work, and we're very much focused on the artistic side of what we do. But for the artistic side of it to thrive, the business side needs to thrive as well.
Yeah.
And when you do those shows or whatever, and you come home the following day, it's very important that your head is in the right place, that you're like, okay, on Monday morning, I can get up and I can do the band taxes, or I can book, you know, the next batch of gigs that are coming up. And I think those are things that you can't really be burning the candle at both ends. If you want things to succeed, something will have to give at some stage. So I'd rather go for a swim than go for a pint. That's about the best way of putting it.
So can you bring me back to the early days, John, and, like, where did music first come into your life? Was it, like, very early on? Are you from a musical family, or?
I'm from a very unmusical family, definitely. I grew up in Ennis in County Clare, just a little bit outside of the town. And my first musical experiences were, I was very lucky, my father worked in the airport, so we had free travel when we were younger. And I think people would find it bizarre now, but I remember my parents, not from a wealthy background at all, but I remember my parents explaining to me when I was a teenager, the reason that we used to go to New York maybe once a year or twice a year was because it was cheaper to go there than it was to go to Dublin. So like we would fly from Shannon to New York, you would do your shopping. There was one time that we flew literally to New York for the day and flew back that night. And you did your clothes shopping or whatever else over there. So I would have spent quite a bit of time in the States because of this opportunity that my father was working in the airport, and we spent holidays over there. And when I was in the States, I started to tune into local radio stations on a Walkman, and I was hearing hip hop where I hadn't heard it in Ireland. I might have heard one or two tracks, but it was really, it like completely arrested me when I heard it for the first time. And I can still remember being in a hotel room with my parents and my sister, and it must have been like 5 o'clock in the morning, and I was still awake going, this music is just amazing to me.
Any particular bands come to mind or acts?
Well, actually, at that time, it wasn't New York, it was Miami. And I was never a massive fan afterwards, but a group called Two Live Crew, where it was this type of music from Miami called booty bass. And to this day, I'm like massive into bass music, and it's the one element of music, I suppose, that resonates with me the most. But you could see cars going down the street, and you could feel the music coming off it. Like there was a very gentle wind of music coming off these cars, and I just was blown away by it. I hadn't heard music like this before, and it seemed so exotic. And it was also the idea of like, how do you make this? This can't be made like with a guitar or drums. I can't figure this out.
Yeah.
And then I made it my business to try and learn as much as I possibly could. I got a Public Enemy tape when I was 10 years of age, and that literally changed my life overnight. So up until this, I had heard, you know, whatever was on the radio and might have heard one or two tracks, but until I got this Public Enemy tape, I got it off a friend of mine who stole it off his older brother for the night and charged me £1 so that I could take it for one night to copy the tape.
Is this guy a millionaire now?
No, but he made a good bit of money out of me.
He showed early signs of enterprise.
That's it, yeah. So I got that Public Enemy tape, and I was just, from there on in, I was kind of sold on it. And I'd never heard the idea of politics in music before that. And from hearing that, it was very obvious, this is like political music. There's a message to this. And I continued to just buy tapes or source tapes. And I heard, I think, Ice Cube pretty soon afterwards. And I think the LA riots had happened maybe the year beforehand, and I had heard that he was talking about the LA riots on this record, but prior to the riots happening. So he, in some sense, he had kind of predicted what was about to happen in Los Angeles. And I just became fascinated that, here's this type of music that is talking about things that, I suppose, just topics that aren't really explored on the news, or I couldn't find it anywhere else. But here it is. It's like this music is the news. Real news.
I have a very similar story, actually. I just was fairly bored for most of my school days. And in one of the, obviously you have compulsory religion in Irish Catholic run schools or whatever. But we had one of these retreat days, and we had these kind of northern youth workers down for the day. But they brought us into a classroom and played Arrested Development for us. And
okay,
there was one song called Mama's Always on Stage.
Yeah.
And it was about a mother that had to turn to kind of prostitution and becoming a stripper in order to feed her child. And we had to kind of unpack that and discuss that. And then I got into Arrested Development, and I started to kind of it was my political education, because there was no civic education at school whatsoever.
Yeah.
And I found that through folk music, through Christy Moore, the likes of Billy Bragg. And so music has served a massive role in my life, and I think it still does today. And it's clear it's influence in your own music.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, again, I did a degree later in life in English and sociology, and if someone had ever asked me, like, why did you go down that route, or what was it about sociology that you were interested, like, I would actually have to say, like, honestly, I heard, like, Rage Against the Machine when I was 12, and they were talking about, you know, issues of social justice and talking about the idea of communism and socialism. And I remember, you know, like, turning around to my mum and going, like, what's communism? She was kind of like, where did this come out of for a 12-year-old? And I was like, oh, I heard this band talking about it. And I think that for me, if someone handed me the Communist Manifesto when I was 12, I never would have read it. If someone had talked to me about civil rights in America at 10 years of age, I probably wouldn't have wanted to learn about it. Mm. But sometimes you can put a message into a song and keep that message quite simple, but that message will just translate over to people. They just feel it because it's in song.
Yeah.
And afterwards, they can get into the nitty-gritty and the details and stuff. But for me, music has always been the medium to open up so many other subjects. Or, you know, like, I never liked science until I realised that music was completely physics, that you can't understand music until you understand physics. And suddenly I was like, oh man, physics is fascinating.
Gotcha.
You know, yeah. So
that kind of brings us into the territory of youth work and informal education, where we can allow people to flourish and develop outside of the prism of straight academia.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you've a background in some youth work as well.
I do, yeah. Like, and again, I suppose everything, all the major turning points in my life, they weren't really conscious decisions. It was just maybe someone would suggest something and I'd say, hey, let's give it a go. So I'm not scared to fail at things, and I fail at things very, very regularly. But I met a guy who just in Limerick, I knew him from Ennis for a good couple of years. And I think I had done maybe one or two workshops in Kerry and in Galway. And just a chap that I know in Limerick was like, I think you'd be good at working with kids and trying to convey what it is that, you know, whether it's DJing or whether it's helping kids to write raps, just kind of facilitating these workshops. So I said I'd give it a go. And that was maybe 7 years ago. I just finished a master's in Limerick and needed some money.
What was the master's in?
The master's was in music technology.
Okay.
So I'm not trained in music. My family aren't musicians. And everything that I've learned through music has just been through trial and error. And I think it's a really good way to approach things. And similarly, I'm not saying that you approach youth work through trial and error, but my early stages in it were very much, I didn't have a background in dealing with young people. I just found that if I went into a room, I could resonate with them in some kind of way and hang out with them, and it didn't seem like it was strained or... and I also found that for me, there's a beautiful thing in watching someone learn. Sometimes when you see someone learning something, you realise, actually, they're doing it quite different, or that technique is different than the way that I would do it. But you pick up on it as well. So you see that you just took one road when there was loads of roads that you could have taken. But I did some work in Limerick, and then I was offered a job with Clare Youth Service in Ennis, which for me was probably the most important element of my education so far, even though it was a job. But I found that the group of people that were in Clare Youth Service at that time, they were just so open-minded. They were very involved in the community, and they gave me the freedom when I came in there to launch this new music project, take it in a completely different direction. I'm sure they thought it was absolutely bonkers at first, but the young people reacted to it. And I then started to realise, okay, like, working with young people is something that I'm actually really passionate about, and I want to see if there's any way that I can work with young people and help develop a local music scene, or give kids the things that I didn't have when I was growing up, whether that's just guidance, whether it's someone to go like, oh, listen, you like industrial music, you know, maybe you should start looking at these bands here, or But definitely Clare Youth Service was one of the places that I learned.
Would you say you had a mentor there, or was there anybody in particular in the youth service that, I mean, you mentioned somebody who saw your potential, and is that somebody who kind of...
I could list, honestly, the entire members of staff. There's one person who I still work with quite closely, Brian McManus, and we still work on a project even today, which is called Five a Day, and that's like mental health workshops where you explore mental well-being through creative arts. And we've been going to schools and we've been just talking about issues with young people. And even that in itself, where, like, again, when I'm saying that, you know, I was never trained technically as a youth worker, but some of the techniques that you learn through dealing with young people and dealing, like, presenting these mental health workshops, they make you question yourself as well.
Of course, yeah.
So that was something that I found really intriguing, where I was like, you know, going back then, I would have been just about to turn 30, and I'm learning all this stuff about myself, but I'm doing it alongside kind of a group of kids of 18 and 19 as well. And I just found that it was a really enriching experience for me being with Clare Youth Service. And the very first day I went in there, I suppose I didn't really know how to interact. And I remember talking to the drugs worker at the time, and I said something really silly, and I just turned around to him and I was like, so you work with all the bad kids? And he just looked at me and he shook his head and he was like, there's no such thing as a bad kid.
Yeah.
And walked away.
Yeah.
And it hit me like a punch. And I was like, why was that such a terrible thing to say? And within 6 months, it was like, I completely understand it.
Yeah, well, that's what we grow up by, segmenting people as others and saying, well, they're the mm-hmm. bad kids. And even the term, I don't even like to use it, but I'm going to use it, the term knackers is used a lot.
Mm, yeah.
And you don't hear it in the media, but you hear it in the streets and in day-to-day language. And it's used to kind of say they're them.
Yeah.
And it dehumanizes someone ultimately.
Yeah, yeah. Like, it's probably important to say that prior to me working with Clare Youth Service, I did an awful lot of projects in Limerick City, and generally, you know, I suppose it's something that's associated with hip-hop, but a lot of the time, the people who are most passionate about hip-hop or want to actually tell their story through rap, a lot of the time, these people come from disadvantaged areas. So my early days of teaching workshops were in South Hill. I did some in Myross. And I even went to halting sites. There was a couple of times I was sent to halting sites, where it's just such a fantastic experience, because here's these groups of people that sometimes society is kind of suggesting that they're not going to create something very astounding. But as soon as I went to those areas and started to engage with those people in terms of creative arts, I was like, my God, like, when you produce something, it's so pure. Be, you know, where they don't feel like they need to be anyone else. It's not a persona. They're just kind of, if a kid from South Hill writes a song, you know that he's putting his heart and soul into that song. So before I came to Clare Youth Service, I'd had this experience of being in quite, I suppose, culturally diverse backgrounds or economically diverse backgrounds. And I just found it really enriching, meeting people from various different places and seeing that everyone has a story, and everyone's story is really as important as anyone else's story as well. It's just how you kind of work with that person to get the story out.
Yeah, yeah. You mentioned the five a day for mental health. What are the five a day?
The five a day for mental health, well, the five a day really can be anything that that you choose to be your five a day. So, I mean, for me, when I'm dealing with young people, one thing that I would say is, like we were talking earlier, I don't really drink. So I'll have a pint occasionally, but it's something that I realise, for me, one pint, I'm fairly happy. 2 pints, I'm really happy. 3 pints, I'm like, this is the worst party in the world ever. So I just realised, you know what, I'm going to cut that out of my life. But everything that you cut out of your life, you kind of have to replace it with something else that's like a reward system. So for me, it's, you know, one positive thing would be getting outdoors, getting close to trees. I just love being around trees. I love being in forests. I wasn't, when I was growing up, I wasn't hugely into exercise, but I make sure that, and even in the studio, I'll stop doing something in the studio, go downstairs and do kettlebells for 20 minutes because it just sharpens your brain so much. Your diet is hugely important, and especially when you're in a band and you're touring from place to place, there is a temptation that you're like, well, I'm just going to have to get another kebab. And we do it in the complete opposite way. Like, people have seen the Rusangano rider and they're like, lads, like, it's all fruit, yogurts, nut bars. But I think one of the most...
You're dispelling loads of hip-hop myths.
I know, yeah. One of the things that comes... Like, when we do these five-a-day mental health workshops, what happens is we talk and interact with the young people. We try and find out what are the difficulties that they face in their lives. What are the things that are like triggers for them? And then we try and see what would they do to combat stress or combat anxiety. And one of the things that always comes up, and I think it's come up in nearly every single workshop, is talk to your mother. Talking to your mother is a very good thing. It doesn't necessarily have to be your mother, but just that there's someone in your life, if you have any issues or there's stress or anxiety, that you're like, hey, I'm going to share this with someone. And yeah, I mean, like anyone else's life, my life hasn't been very straightforward, or it hasn't been very easy. And there has definitely been times where it's been extremely challenging. And I've had to use like the techniques that were taught to me, you know, through youth work and stuff, and kind of go, actually, I need to take like a leaf out of my own book here, because things are stressful at the moment. And it's so simple. Sometimes even just remembering to breathe. It's such a simple idea, but just to breathe regularly, to take big deep breaths, to calm yourself down, that every situation is manageable no matter what it is. It's just the way that you approach it. And I think within Rusangano, that's something that, again, stressing the thing as an independent act, some of the things that we do can seem quite daunting, but I think we have a really strong bond between the three of us. Like, we would say that we all feel like brothers together. So while I would be petrified to go out into the National Concert Hall and, you know, perform there by myself, you feel just enriched by the fact that you're like, well, it's fine, I got my two lads here. And we'll always talk about the anxiety of doing a show, or talk about the anxiety of being in the band in some kind of way, or the stresses that go with it. So that will be another one of the five a day. I think I've hit five. I'm not sure, have I?
You're thereabouts.
My one is make some music, because it's one of the most therapeutic things that you can do. You can get any negative emotions that you have, you can turn it into something beautiful, just by trying to make some music or draw a picture or do a sculpture. Anything like that. Anything that's, I suppose, a creative way to take whatever you're feeling and put it on a page.
Expression, I think, is a big one, because mm-hmm. I think sometimes what's happening is people are feeling this angst or rage or frustration, and it's becoming internalized, and it can manifest itself maybe as self-harm or eating disorder or depression, whereas it is better out, whether it's shared or through music or mm-hmm. And I actually enjoy the fact that sometimes rage is expressed through music as well, because anger and rage are things that are quite often suppressed by society. Mm-hmm. But I think it's important to hear rage.
Yeah, definitely. And I know that there are parts when, even just looking at it, like, I'll be honest with you, sometimes I see photographs of Rusangano alive and I barely recognize myself, and I'm like, why are you shouting? Like, why is your mouth open so much? And I think that there's an element of that we all find the live show therapeutic, where, and particularly for the lads, because they're talking about things that were particularly problematic or challenging for them growing up. And it's one thing to put it into a song. It's another thing to actually stand on stage and proudly say that out to everyone. Because, you know, at first you're going to be nervous when you say it, and you're going to be self-conscious. But after a while, I think that actually it does the complete opposite, and it kind of strengthens you, and you're like, you know what, I'm going to tell you everything, I'm going to lay it all out for you, because that's the thing that people will connect with most, and they will respect you for it. And any time that I'm working with young people in a songwriting capacity, that's one thing that I say: don't ever be scared to put your deepest kind of emotions down on the page. No one will judge you for it. They'll actually respect you for it way more because you've had the courage to stand up and say, you know what, I'm going to put this out there to the world. And I think it's really important.
Yeah, you know? I find that a lot with public speaking. So I do a lot of public speaking, and occasionally people ask me for advice. And it might be a bit cliched to say, but the authenticity, I think, is the number one rule. So you don't need to be a prolific speaker and have the biggest vocabulary and have the slickest moves. Mm-hmm. But if you are speaking from your heart, and if you're stumbling, it doesn't matter. People are going to connect. There's a real live human being in front of me.
For sure.
And they're giving it to me real. Because there's so much superficial crap around these days. Mm-hmm. People are going for the slick. But I like that I don't know. I find hope in the fact that I believe there is a return to authenticity and an acknowledgement, well, that's real. And I think you guys are mirroring that to some extent. And I think that's partially what's attracting the world to you. So I foresee great things for you, you know.
Thanks for letting.
Beyond Ireland. And not that that necessarily matters, but mm-hmm. I think, you know, it's off its time.
Yeah. Well, I think you're definitely right in the idea about authenticity, and particularly in the arts. But it feels like it's everywhere, that it's kind of invaded society in a little bit, where over like maybe a 10 or a 15 year period, we haven't been as genuine as we should. I'm not someone who's massively into social media. I'm into social media because I'm in a band and it's part of my job being in a band. Beyond that, I don't really have any interest in it. And what I kind of feel what's going with social media is something that it's a fantastic gift, because I spoke to my friend in London last night. I spoke to a buddy of mine in the States during the week, and my girlfriend lives in Finland. So I speak to her. I have dinner with my girlfriend where she prepares her meal and I prepare my meal in Ireland, and we sit down and we have to talk via like FaceTime or Skype or whatever. But that's an amazing thing where it's like, okay, I'm not going to see you for 3 weeks, but I'm going to interact with you every single day through the internet. So there are some absolutely fantastic things behind it. I think it's a double-edged sword though as well, where a lot of it becomes about appearance, and our social status before we even walk outside is defined by that personality that we've developed for ourselves online. So that you could walk down the street and I may have never have met you, but I would know quite a lot about you because I can follow you on Twitter, or I can, you know, like your page on Facebook. And everyone just has these false concepts of what everyone else is like. And I think they're slower to interact with people because they feel like they already know that person.
Yeah, it's a funny, I met a guy in a shop the other day that followed me on Twitter, and it was just an awkward moment where I didn't know what he knew about me or
okay,
not.
Okay, yeah.
But most of what I share on Twitter is quite political, and then mm-hmm. I'm conscious of that and thinking that there's more to me than that. I do have the crack and
fun.
So maybe I should put up photos of me eating dinner or something. But it's an interesting one. But I would particularly worry about people that feel they have to maintain that image, that maybe because we don't necessarily put all our shit on social media, like the gloomy, dark days that everybody has.
Yeah.
And I worry about that, particularly that people don't understand that life is all about suffering and joy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just the joy element. And I'm not saying that we should just share all the suffering either, but I find that, like in the mental health work in particular, to acknowledge that, and I like that about Buddhism, that if you acknowledge suffering is part of life, it's no big deal. It's
for just, sure. Yeah.
Suffer and the clouds will flow on by. And
yeah. I just finished reading an Alan Watts book that was talking about Zen. And it again, I could find so much depth in it, where some of the things that it's saying in, like I said, my life hasn't been that easy. There's been some severe challenges. But I think that a lot of the reason that things are maybe, I wouldn't say successful for me now, but I think that they're hopefully going in the right direction, is because you allow those challenges in your life. You can't walk away from a challenge. And when these challenges come into your life, it's accepting them, looking at them, taking them apart, dealing with them, but moving on from it and realizing that when you move on from a challenge, you're a stronger person, that you can face, you know, the bigger the challenge that you face, it's how insignificant the small challenges seem afterwards, where you just don't care about the small trivial things anymore. It's like, that's not a real big issue, do you know?
Yeah,
I think it's really important to realize life is full of light and darkness. But the darkness isn't something that we should all try and run away from. And I think that that's, you know, some of the time we're all trying to present that we only have lives that are full, bright, that we're always out for dinner. But like, that's not the reality of it.
You're at home doing the dishes.
Yeah, do you know, like, yeah. You never see people taking like photos of like really bad dinners that they cooked. Do you know, here's chicken nuggets and beans. Like,
yeah. So do you live alone or do you live with lads or what?
I live with one other housemate at the moment. And
do you cook chicken nuggets?
Or? I don't cook chicken nuggets at all. A lot of salads, and the most important thing is a big breakfast in the morning.
Do you have a vice? Because you're too clean living here at this
I have numerous vices that I probably won't talk about here, but but a vaporizer is one of them anyway that I can speak of. And coffee and a vaporizer, they're the ones that that I'll admit to. I'm certainly not the most clean living person, but I definitely realise that life is about balance, and I want to be healthy enough to enjoy life.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know
what? And where did you meet the lads?
I met the lads through, again, Clare Youth Service, to give it its credit. I was involved in a thing in Ennis which was called the Ennis Street Festival, and Ennis is a small town where it has a very strong tradition of Irish music. But for me, it's, and I'm interested in Irish music, but what I've kind of felt is that to a certain extent, it has, I don't want to say strangled, but it has slowed down the development of other culture, artistic culture, I think, within the town, because that's so dominant. You know, it's like, if I'm sure badminton isn't massive in Kerry because everyone's playing football.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Kind of way. But I was working for the Ennis Street Festival, or doing some stuff with them, and they allowed me the platform to put some bands and some acts on in the centre of town in Ennis. And through the youth service, I had been booking acts, I had been working with young groups around the county, and I just got to the stage where I was like, I really don't want to put on a four-piece band with bass, drums, guitars and vocals and singer-songwriters. I just want to make sure that there's something different as well. And I had met, God knows, a couple of years previously on this broadcast that was a transatlantic broadcast that I was involved in Limerick. Took place in Limerick, but it was broadcast in the United States. So there was a guy over there that had realised there's a bit of a hip-hop scene developing in Ireland, and I'd like to do a special on it. So he asked us to broadcast from Limerick, and then it would be transmitted in the States. And I met God knows at that, and he was quite young at the time, but I remember I was DJing in the background, and while he was being interviewed, he kept letting off these like, "Woo, yeah!" Because he liked the music that I was playing. So fast forward maybe 2 or 3 years later, I said, I'm going to book these guys for this street festival in Ennis and let's see how it goes. And they showed up, I'd say maybe 12 of them showed up, and they just did like a live grime set in Ennis at 3 p.m. in the day. That's about 4.5 years ago.
Do you find grime here?
Grime as in like the, what would you say, indigenous urban music of the UK, current indigenous urban music of the UK. And so the guys did this set in the middle of the street and it went off. In the middle of Venice, it went off. I still have footage of it. And I remember going home that night and watching the video over and over, and I was like, this is crazy that this could happen. And I had been DJing for, like, my background, I've been heavily involved in music since I am 17 years of age. So I've ran gigs, I have had, which we won't cover, but I had a period as a rapper.
Anything on YouTube?
No.
Is the grime set on YouTube?
It isn't, no. But I may upload it, some footage of it.
Yeah. Well, when they make the documentary about the band, then...
There you go. Yeah, it's important to have that stuff. But so I had been involved in music for a while. I had produced two EPs of my own music at this stage. And I was looking to work with a vocalist. And I just knew on that day, it was like, oh... I think this is it. This is the guy. So myself and God Knows worked together, and very quickly Merle came into the scene as well. And it's something that he actually mentioned in an interview last week. We never formally asked Merle to become part of the band. It just materialized. It was like, well, he's perfect, isn't he? And now it's even better than it was before. And yeah, we just, there's a bond between the three of us where, I think deep down inside, I was very driven in music, but there's an Irish mentality of, you never want to actually say, I'm kind of driven and I want to achieve something here. And I remember meeting God Knows. He asked me for a quick meeting to do with funding at one stage. And he showed up to Clare Youth Service in a suit. And I was very impressed that he was wearing a suit. And I remember I was like, what do you want to do? And he was like, like, I want to be the biggest artist in the world. And I was like, wow. Like, I love this moxie, the way he just comes in and says it. And to a certain extent, I think a little of that kind of rubbed off after a while, where it's like, well, why are we kidding ourselves here? Let's not, you know, aim for middle height. Let's aim right for the top. And if you don't achieve, if you don't get right to the top, so what? But if you get most of the way up the ladder, that's significantly better than saying, like, oh, I just do it for the crack.
Yeah.
I just do it for the crack. And, like, look, it's important to have the crack. But, like, I actually want to do this for as long as I possibly can. I want the lads to make as big an impact as they can, because I think I genuinely feel like they deserve it.
Well, what do you think's driving them? I mean, obviously they're not here to speak for themselves, but have you a sense of... like the collective motivation and then the individual motivation?
I think it's been there in them for a very, very long time as well. All three of us, our most kind of formative years are kind of 10 to 14. I think anyway, where that's where music really hit us and the decisions were nearly made at that age. But maybe didn't vocalize those decisions until like early 20s. But in your own head, it was like the decision was made.
Can you give me a quick background on the two lads? Because for people listening who don't know them or where they're from.
So God Knows is from, he's based in Shannon. And he's living in Shannon for, I think, about 13 or 14 years. He's originally from Zimbabwe. And I believe he was living in the UK for about a year before his family moved over here. And his father is an airplane engineer, I believe. And that's why he would have located to Shannon. And Shannon would be quite a multicultural area because of the airport being there. It's a new town. It was a planned town. It's... would be the most multicultural part, I suppose, of Clare. Merle, I think, moved to Ireland around the same time. His story is a little bit different. Merle is from Togo, and his family left Togo when some of the trouble erupted in Togo, and they kind of knew that, like, in terms of the politics there, this isn't going to improve. So he left and went to Ghana, and I think when he was in Ghana, trouble erupted in Ghana as well. Had to go back to Togo and then eventually travel to Ireland. So, like, both the lads have nearly 50% of their life was spent in their home country and 50% of their life was spent in Ireland. So it's interesting, and I think it's a particularly interesting story for them because their parents are African. The lads are the first generation of people who kind of moved over here. But you're never going to have that in the same kind of way again, in that when God Knows has children, or when Merle has children, those are, they're just Irish kids. They grew up in Ireland, and they probably won't understand Africa and, or African culture in the same kind of way. Whereas both God Knows and Merle are very interesting people because they're Irish in the way that they will interact with you, but they have such strong ties to their African roots and to their African culture. And, you know, the both of them will greet you with a "how ya," and are interested in Irish culture and then very interested in their own traditions and stuff as well. And I think what they're doing lyrically is they're tackling something that wasn't tackled in, I've looked around for people who were tackling the idea of migration in lyrics, and MIA is one of the only people that I could find. But even some of their music would predate all of that. I have a lot of, respect for what the lads have done, for the way that they've, sometimes I suppose there are different communities, especially in rural Ireland. If you come from a migrant background, those communities can kind of stay separate than the traditional Irish community. Like, they're on the outskirts. And I love the way God Knows and Merle have just, like, walked straight into Irish society and said, "This is who we are," and, like, "get to know us." And it's fantastic. It's really, really good. And they've been embraced hugely, I think, as well, where people are like, finally, someone is representing modern Ireland and talking about the issues of modern Ireland. Because stereotypically, if you think of an Irish person, it's, you know, it's going to be a white guy with a hurley in his hand. And we have to be honest that, like, the country that we live in, it's not like that anymore. Do you know, it has diversified. And particularly when you come to Dublin and you walk around Dublin, you're like, this is such a multicultural city. And we have to respect the fact that it's a multicultural city. And there's just so much to benefit in terms of individuals from spending time with different people from different backgrounds and just learning, I see that you may see the world slightly different than how I see it. And I start to get an understanding as to why you see the world different. And I start to see the biases that I have as well. And it just becomes really, really interesting that I think the more people that you can interact with, the more enriching, like, the experience is, do you know?
Are you experiencing particularly in, well, Ennis, maybe, as you said, that whole area, Shannon, Ennis, it's a little bit more multicultural than other towns, but it's clear to me that racism is quite prevalent in Ireland, and I get a little bit of trolling online where they attack me for different things.
But yeah.
I mean, I can survive. I'm a big white guy. Mm-hmm. But I've seen young Irish people who aren't white get attacked in the most nastiest of ways. Is that something you're aware of? Or?
I have to be honest here. For me, probably not. Because obviously I'm the white Irish guy in the group, do you know? So for me, it isn't an issue. I do know that we released a single last year, and when we put it up online, there was some questionable comments on YouTube. And then the more that we looked at it, like, a lot of the time, it's just complete ignorance. It's stupidity. And it's very easy for me to say, like, don't pay any attention to it. But it's not targeting me. So I'm not really in a position to say, like, well, this is hurtful or this isn't hurtful.
Yeah.
It comes down to whoever is feeling targeted by these comments or by these agendas that people have. One thing that I will say was there was one particular character who kept commenting on our YouTube video over and over and over again. And eventually we were like, I think we're going to have to say something here. So we posted a comment that said... chap's name was Eric, so we're like, dear Eric, it seems like you don't like us, but we love you, so we'd like to meet with you and we would love to have a chat if you're available to sit down and have a conversation with us at any stage. We'd really appreciate it. And he came back and he was like, absolutely no way would I do this, blah blah blah, and it continued on for a while and we stopped kind of paying attention because it was like, yeah, this is like, just don't want to waste my time looking at this. But when we went back and checked it a couple of months later, he had a comment up where he's like, something along the lines of, I need to apologize for everything that I've said here. I've actually interacted with some people outside of my own community and it's been a brilliant experience. So I want to apologize. And we were like, what? No way. Like, that in itself was a really... that's what Rusangano is about to a certain extent. It's like, meet people that you don't know, do things that you don't normally do, and see how you see if you enjoy the experience. But don't say that you hate something until you try it, because it's all about learning. If you go into a situation with an open mind, you'll probably find when you walk away from it, you're like, that was great. That was brilliant. If you walk into a situation with your biases in place, you're already shutting yourself off from having a good experience. So we just, I think, try and stay as open as we can. And it's something that, yeah, but being in this band has been important for all three of us. We've all said it for our own personal development in some kind of way and learning more about people, how to interact with people and how not to interact with people as well.
God, so we still have to meet Eric.
Yeah.
He might be at the gig later. Can you talk to me just, we're going to wrap up soon, but I'm just curious about how the album came about, because I've heard a little bit and I understand that it was a kind of a DIY endeavor,
mm-hmm.
and so many ways it's part of a heroic journey. There was no big record industry, no big money, mm-hmm. no big studio.
Mm-hmm. Let the Dead Bury the Dead was self-released. We had done some projects beforehand, so myself and God Knows released, I suppose you could call it an album, called Rusangano/Family. That was one of the first things that we did together, and I think we released that in 2014. And there's, for me, from a personal side, I suppose it's kind of important to say, the day that we were due, we picked a starting point for that particular project, and it was the 1st of January 2014. And on that particular day, we'd been building up to it, but on that particular day, I got some bad news that my father was diagnosed with cancer. And I remember thinking, like, okay, well, that's it. This project is gone now, because I'm going to have to be a carer here. This is a serious kind of things, like, life has suddenly got very real. And I think I had a conversation with God Knows at probably 3 o'clock that day to cancel the session and be like, this isn't going to happen. Like, and I don't think it's going to happen at all. I don't think we're going to be able to do this. And then I probably rang him at 10 o'clock and I was like, this is on. Like, we're going ahead with this, and we're just going to make sure that we make really good music. So the whole time that we've been making music, I was kind of caring for my dad at the time. And prior to us sitting down to make Let the Dead Bury the Dead, my father passed away. And it had been there so much in the background, where, you know, you're achieving things, but at the same time, it's kind of like, people would see you achieving things and think, God, it's fantastic, but they don't see the other story behind it. And the lads, coincidentally, at the same time, they had their struggles that they needed to overcome as well, in terms of, I suppose, just difficulties in their lives. So all three of us were in a position where it's like, this is really tough. And when we went to make an album, we went to make Let the Dead Bury the Dead. I remember we were driving in a car one day, and God knows said it as like a throwaway. So it's important to say the guys are Christians, and I'm very much not. I like couldn't be further from it. So there is all these cultural and cultural differences within the group, but yet we're still get on like a house on fire. But I remember one day God knows said, "Let the dead bury the dead," and I was like, "What?" And he was like, "Let the dead bury the dead," and I was like, "That's gonna be the album title, like that's it right now." And so before we even wrote a song, it was like, okay, that's the album title, now we have to make it.
Yeah.
And that was always, I suppose, there, that what we wanted to do. People were seeing the live shows, they could see that we're energetic, it's colourful, but for us it was kind of like, it's really important that this is balanced as well, that people see, like, despite all the smiles and jumping around, like, we have very serious lives when we're not on stage and we're dealing with some very serious things here. I think that what we tried to do was just immerse ourselves in that idea. Album was made largely in a spare bedroom in my house, which is, it's a studio, like, and we've added more and more to it.
Wasn't some of it made in the car as well?
That was the first project.
Oh, the first project.
Yeah, so the first project, and again, just to say, it was made in hospital waiting rooms, and it was then, like, for me to be able to hear it back properly, I used to plug in the laptop in the car. But it, generally, that was hanging around hospitals all the time.
So when they talk about blood, sweat and tears, there were tears.
Literally blood, sweat and tears.
Yeah.
That was in the first project. And then going into this, it was kind of, I think, you hold on to a lot of grief. And especially when you're caring for someone as well. So when my dad passed away, my mum actually needed to be cared for then. So I took over kind of caring for my mum. And the music was the thing. The music was the medium to kind of go, like, let's get all of this out. Like you said, when, you know, the idea of rage and shouting or whatever, it was kind of like, it's all going to go into the music.
Yeah, Amanda Palmer talks about it's the shit that makes the flowers grow in terms of community.
You got it. Yeah. So I think all three of us were very clear on the idea that if we're going to do this, it has to be as honest as possible. Like, it is, there's no makeup. It's, you know, scars and spots and everything is going to go into this. Like, you have to see the true reflection. And we make music very easily. We don't struggle with it. We're not, thankfully anyway, we're not people that are kind of like, oh, the creative juices aren't flowing. We all go through periods of, I haven't made anything in a month, or I haven't written anything in a month or whatever, but we're all quite encouraging within the group, where it's like, look, it'll come around. We just said we're going to do this ourselves from start to finish. We went to America to play some shows, and just when we came home, we heard from a record label, which would have been really big to me when I was growing up as a teenager. So a lot of my favourite acts were all on this record label, and they got in touch with us, and they're like, we didn't see one of your shows, but we've got a phone call. Someone rang us from Austin, Texas, in New York, and was like, sign these guys now. So the lady said, when is your album coming out? And we were like, 3 weeks time. And she said, okay, I want you to put it back for 6 months and we'll release it, and we'll, you know, give it the proper treatment that it needs. And just for us, we were like, we can't do that, because we've already told the people that it's coming out, and we owe it to the people to put it out. And she was kind of like, you're going to do it independently? Like, I can put money behind this. And we were just like, no. Like, we made a promise to the people, we're not breaking the promise to the people. So we released it ourselves. And each time that we do something, we learn more and more and more.
I'm guessing none of you have big bags of cash.
Oh, certainly not. No, look, you're talking to three youth workers. Like, and as a former youth worker, you know, the pay is okay.
Recovering, yeah.
yeah. So
pay is not okay, John. It's enough to live on, but you'd never save anything to bankroll a music career.
So, but we've never taken. Occasionally, you get a new pair of trainers if you're in Rusangano. But other than that,
yeah, you do nice. Trainers.
There you go.
Nice New Balance there. So I need to Instagram a photo of those.
There you go. Yeah. So occasionally you get a new pair of trainers or. Like if I need whatever materials I need to make the music, so we make sure that we invest in good microphones, we invest in good mixers and anything like that. But all the rest of the money, we actually just keep it and we go, this is to further the group because we want this to develop into something and you need the overheads for it. We were very lucky in that we have got some support from Limerick City of Culture 2020, and also the Clare Arts Office have occasionally give us small little bursaries as well to work with. Yeah. So that's what allowed us to do it. One grant of €300 will allow Rusangano to put their debut album out.
Doesn't that show you the power of funders and funding and even small amounts of funding and why artists need support?
Mm-hmm. And you can do all this yourself. I suppose we were lucky in that I had written for music magazines before, so I was aware of how to write a press release, who to send them to, small little things within the press industry. We might have had a little bit of a head start just because I'd had a background in it. But yeah, anyone can do this.
Didn't you get a big support slot?
Oh, we did. Yeah, we got a few. So. The one that you're probably talking about is Snoop Dogg.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You might want to mention that.
So Snoop Dogg heard... Someone played Snoop Dogg some of our music. And I remember sitting in a buddy's house that night. And my Twitter started to get more and more active. And then it got to the point of the phone was just on full-on vibration the whole way through. And I was like, something's going on. My buddy was kind of like, what? And I was like, I don't know, but I think that Snoop Dogg likes us. And he was like, what? And then maybe a couple of hours later, the phone went and it was like, yes, it transpired that Snoop Dogg was going to be coming to Ireland. Someone had passed him our music. He liked it and was like, will you come and do the support for 2 nights? So for us, that was just... mind blown.
That you're was talking about 10,000 crowds. Is that in the
no? It was actually it was
point,
it, no. It was in the academy, so it was like real reduced down crowd.
But it was a pretty hardcore crowd.
Oh, for sure, yeah. And it would have been the biggest audience that we would have played to certainly at that point. And that really was something that kind of got the wheels in motion for us. And people were like, why would Snoop Dogg take an interest in this Irish act? And we met some other people along the way. We played at a wedding in Galway and we were in the middle of performing at this wedding and someone was jumping beside me and I was like, oh, they're making the record skip. And then when I turned, it was Ed Sheeran. And I was like, what? Like, Ed Sheeran is dancing on the stage here beside me? So he had been at the wedding and afterwards he sat and talked with us and was like, guys, this is... you know, really good stuff. And I remember 2 days later he was interviewed on Today FM and someone was like, is there any Irish act that you like at the moment? And he was like, actually, there's this rap group from Limerick. And the host was like, the Rubber Bandits. And he was like, no, actually, I think it's called God Knows and My Name is John or something. So that was great. And we did some support with a group called Run the Jewels as well, who... That was quite early on, and they would have been, for me, LP was kind of like my hero as a producer, and I loved the politics that Killer Mike was presenting publicly. And when we performed with them, they just afterwards backstage said some stuff to us where it was like the real pinch yourself moment where are they telling us that we're good, and they're actually saying like they didn't seem like they were faking it. They were kind of like, whoa, you're really good. And that's when we were kind of like, okay, I think we should really, really start to take this serious, because anyone that we've played with who we really admire isn't looking at us like, you know, just the support act that's brought in on the day. They seem to want to meet us afterwards and talk to us And yeah, it's just, you know, you got to take every experience like that for us is an amazing gift. It's brought us to another platform afterwards. And we've used those things as well. That's important to say, that it's not like we just went and did it and we never mentioned it again. We've used those things to go, these are stepping stones. These put us in a slightly stronger position, whether it's dealing with a promoter or dealing with a festival or even just to interact with those people online every now and again. We're not in regular contact with Snoop Dogg or Ed Sheeran, I can promise you that. But yeah, just to keep relationships going and to strengthen, I think, your own belief in yourself, where you actually feel like you can do this. And it's something that it's very hard to explain to people, how to have the courage to stand up and go, I'm going to give this as good a go as I possibly can. And I don't care what anyone says. And like, literally, I don't care what anyone thinks of Rusangano, because I'm having the best time doing it. But if you can kind of throw off the shackles of worrying about what someone is going to think or whether someone is going to judge you in some kind of way, you find that it just becomes so easy because you're so relaxed, like trying to achieve what it is that you want to achieve. If you achieve it, brilliant. If you don't, well, nothing ventured, nothing gained, but you probably end up on a very interesting path in life where there's so much more adventures that are about to come. Like, I don't know in 5 years' time if I'm going to be making rap music, but I'm pretty sure that I probably won't be going back to the youth services in the capacity that I was in before. And that's not to say that I don't want to do this. I always want to interact with young people because I think it's a really important thing. And I think it's really important for me as well, because I learn as much. Every time I work with a young person, I learn probably twice as much as they do, just to see their outlook on life. And also to see, it's a great thing to spend time with a young person, because when you're a little bit older, you have seen, you've seen the puddles of life a little bit, you know? And it's great when you are interacting with young people and it's just all optimism and, you know, like the world is still so full of wonder, like, and like, they have the potential to achieve anything. Sometimes young people don't actually, it's like they don't see it in themselves. And I probably definitely didn't see it in myself as a teenager. But more so now it's kind of like, yeah, I want to help people. If I feel like that kid is going someplace or that kid has got a calling, but he just doesn't know that he has a calling, I want to try and help in whatever way that I can, doing something like that. So if music doesn't work out, I may go back down that route, but it'll be a different route, because of decisions that we've made to progress as a band. And I don't think anyone should be ever scared to stand up and go, I'm going to give this a go. If it doesn't work out, it doesn't matter. You know, it's about the journey. It's not about where you're trying to get to. It's the crack that you're having on the journey. That's the most important thing, I think.
And clarification for anybody from the US that is listening, that crack is not the drug. So on that note, I really, really appreciate all that nuggets of wisdom. And maybe we'll do another interview in 10 years and find out where all this leads to.
So. Yeah, yeah. I'll probably be back being a youth worker.
I'll be applying for grants for a youth service from you guys.
Brilliant.
Look, thanks so much, John.
No, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Love and Courage podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. I'd really love if you could subscribe to the podcast, rate it and review it, and spread the word on social media and wherever you can. While I love doing these interviews, they take a lot of time and effort in research, production, post-production and publicity, and there are some costs involved. If you would like to chip in and help the podcast grow, it would be really appreciated. All contributions welcome, and monthly patrons can receive a Love and Courage t-shirt, badge, special mentions online and discounts on future workshops and events. And this support helps me to help others in the community in my day-to-day work. My sincere thanks to all of you who have already supported in so many different ways. Also, just to say, I sometimes take on social change media, communications campaigns and strategic projects, and do talks and presentations, workshops in schools and colleges, community centres and at conferences. Topics range from mental health and personal personal development to youth and community empowerment, leadership, activism, and social innovation. If you're interested in learning more about any of this, please let me know. So to get in touch, to offer feedback or suggestions, or to make a financial contribution right now, log on to loveandcourage.org or send me an email to podcast@loveandcourage.org. Thank you so much for all your support. Until next time, here's to you, to all of us, and to having the courage to create big change in our lives and in the world around us.